This is Portsmouth, home of the Royal Navy and a vital part of Britain's defences for centuries. Nelson set off from here when he went to command the fleet at the Battle of Trafalgar. And way over there, built at a time when we really did rule the waves, is Britain's first naval hospital. But it's in the grounds of the hospital that you find the real story, because an unmarked cemetery contains the bodies of thousands of sailors who made it here alive, but would never leave.
He's young, very young, about 17 and 18. You can see that the third molar is just coming up.
Now, archaeologists are uncovering fascinating insights into the lives and deaths of the men who served their country during this pivotal time in British history. For much of the 18th century, Britain's security depended on the power of the Royal Navy. It was the most successful fighting force in the world, and in 1805, its supremacy was spectacularly confirmed. The British fleet defeated the combined might of the French and Spanish navies off the southwest coast of Spain without the loss of a single ship. The Battle of Trafalgar was a tremendous success, the most celebrated in British naval history. And when the fleet arrived triumphantly back in Portsmouth 6 weeks later, Haslar Naval Hospital was the first stop for the sick and the wounded. Some were nursed back to health, others died and are buried in the hospital grounds. For 250 years, Haslar has treated members of the Navy, but in 2009, it's closing down. As part of the closure programme, archaeologists from Cranfield University have been called in to investigate the hospital cemetery. Time Team's Helen Geek and Phil Harding are following the dig, which is being overseen by Dr. Andrew Shortland.
A plan of Haslar Farm, purchased by the Crown in the year, was that 1745?
1745, yeah.
To erect an hospital for sick and hurt seamen of the Royal Navy. So obviously within that they had to make contingencies for the fact that people were going to die, and there's labelled here burial ground, which is this sort of extremity at the end. Is that more or less where we are now?
Yes, it is. We're standing just here, just in the corner of the burial ground marked on this.
And it says 9 acres. How big is it?
Well, about 4 or 5 football pitches.
That's quite a sizeable area.
The sheer scale of the plot suggests the Navy knew that many patients would never recover. Thousands are believed to be buried here, but no one knows exactly how many, because any burial markers were removed long ago.
Flip. Okay, stop.
So who would have been buried in this burial ground?
Seamen from the hospital, and then seamen who died in the anchorage out at Spithead over here.
So, I mean, this would have included officers, able seamen, ratings, everybody who died would have been buried here.
All ranks.
Don't take any more off him. Just tidy around the edges.
Presumably, there would have been a seriously regular transport of little ships going in and out, bringing the casualties and sick off of the ships.
Absolutely, yes. Yeah.
But equally, you know how this steady stream of fatalities coming out of the hospital, the people who didn't make it, into the burial ground.
Yeah, that's right. In one end of the hospital and out of the other.
He's got wisdom teeth. And he's got...
Haslar's cemetery buried men of all ranks on an industrial scale. Many would have been casualties of battle, because Britain was at war for much of the 18th century and needed a constant supply of sailors to man the fleet. Bolstered by the manufacturing muscle of the Royal Dockyards, the Navy became the largest industrial unit in the world. And I'm off to try and find out what part Haslar played in this mighty machine. This is the entrance to Portsmouth Harbour, and in the middle of the 18th century, it would have been littered with boats coming in and out of the harbour and going to and from the big battleships, which were anchored just off the coast. The sick and wounded would have been ferried to Haslar in those boats from the big ships, and I'm going to make the same journey that they made, although in a much faster and more comfortable boat. hospital was built on Haslar Creek on the western side of the harbour. Indeed, the phrase up the creek is supposed to have originated with sailors who thought if they were ever rowed up Haslar Creek, that would mean they were in serious trouble. After they landed at the jetty, the sick and the wounded were put into handcarts and pushed about 300 yards until they came to the entrance of the hospital. That is until the 1870s, when the Navy put in these tram tracks for a kind of tram ambulance to speed up the transfers. Haslar provided the blueprint for further naval hospitals at Plymouth and Chatham. They were built near major ports to save the cost of transporting sick sailors to London. Built in 1746, Haslar had beds for 1,800 patients and cost £100,000.
It's really magnificent.
At the time, it was the largest construction project in Britain. For the next 250 years, the hospital treated the wounded from major battles such as Trafalgar and Waterloo, as well as from both world wars. It later took in casualties from the First Gulf War and the conflict in Iraq. I've come to meet naval historian Professor Andrew Lambert, who's going to help me piece together its early history.
Hi, Andrew. This place is huge. Why did they build it? And why did they build it so big?
In the middle of the 18th century, the Royal Navy is the biggest military organisation in the world. It's the key to Britain's world power. The British control the world trading network, and the Navy gives them the ability to stop everybody else trading, to tax that trade, to direct it into British harbours. Without the Navy, Britain goes from being a world power to being a peripheral bit-part player. So the Navy is everything, and keeping the sailors fit and healthy, keeping the supply of sailors in wartime up to the right level, that's what this place is all about.
When the Navy was short of men, press gangs forced sailors into service. Thousands of these unwilling recruits would take the opportunity to desert while being ashore sick. So, in a bid to stop patients escaping, Haslar was built at the end of an isolated peninsula, a valuable deterrent in the 18th century when most sailors couldn't swim. Would-be deserters were faced with the prospect of drowning in the sea on one side or in Haslar Creek on the other.
Desertion was such a problem in the Georgian Navy that Haslar was as much of a prison as it was a hospital. Down here is the outlet of the main hospital sewer, and a lot of patients risked the delights of escaping through it by lowering themselves through the hospital bogs. Yes, they really were called bogs in those days. In fact, the problem grew so widespread that at low tide, a marine was posted here to prevent further escapes.
Others escaped by tying bedsheets together and letting themselves down from the upper floors. The hospital responded by putting guards on the gates, iron bars on the windows, and locking the wards at night. One patient even bled to death because doctors couldn't get past the large number of padlocks securing the doors. So Haslar was a hospital, but not as we know it. It carefully controlled departures as well as admissions. Men either left cured and went back out on ships, or they went out the back of the hospital into the cemetery.
So we're going to lift the mandible, each half, into the box. He's young, very young. You can see that the third molar is just coming up, and that usually happens between the ages of about 17 and 18.
He has a very long humour eye.
He does, doesn't he?
He must be very tall.
As part of their task, the Cranfield University archaeologists need to estimate how many people are buried here. So they've calculated the density of burials in their trenches.
We can look at how many burials lie completely within the trench. And if we do that, we can see that there are 9. And then obviously there are lots of partials here. So if we look at how many partials there are and add up the halves and the quarters and all the little bits, we come up with another 11. Full burials, making 20 full burials. And it's a 2-metre trench and it's 25 metres long. So the maths is relatively simple. 50 square metres there.
And then you calculate the density of burials for that trench.
Yeah, just divide one by the other.
Which in this instance is 0.4 burials per square metre.
That's right. We do this with all of the trenches that we have and we work out the area of the entire burial ground and we come up with a number and that's just under 8,000.
It's a lot of burials.
Yeah, it is. It's a very significant number of burials. Just under 8,000 purely on the archaeology.
These are just 30 of those 8,000 men. Their bodies reveal stories of childhood poverty, traumatic injury, and crippling disease. It's an extraordinary insight into life at sea in the 18th century and death at Haslar. The dig at Haslar Naval Hospital has revealed that an estimated 8,000 bodies are buried in this unmarked cemetery. The skeletons exhumed so far are now providing clues as to how these men died and the gruelling existence of sailors in the 18th century Navy.
Extra bony growth is where...
Cranfield University's Dr. Anna Williams has been analysing the bones.
This one, we think, has suffered a major accident, such as falling off the rigging, and he's broken six bones in his body all at the same time.
Six bones? So where's the first break?
Here, on his right upper arm, we can see that this bone broke in two places, and this little fragment of bone got moved out of place.
And where else is the next fracture?
There's another one. Here, on his left forearm, we can see another break.
So he's lost the use of both arms?
Yes, and his leg. There's a big fracture to his leg. We can see that there's new bony formation here, which shows that he survived.
So we got two arms and a leg. What else?
He also suffered a massive fracture to the centre of his jaw. It's gone up the middle of his jaw.
So he's literally probably fallen from a great height, landing slap face down on the deck, bang.
Yes, and the force would have travelled up his jaw and broken off the two joints where his jaw articulates with his skull. We can see that these ends have broken off.
But it may not be the breaks that killed him.
No, we know that he survived the breaks for a few months, but it's likely that he eventually succumbed to infection.
Serving on a Royal Naval Man of War was clearly not for the faint-hearted. The very design of these ships meant any sailor on board could all too easily end up at Haslar.
Life on a ship like this, as you can see, it's all about this enormous amount of rigging. This is what powers the ship. So you've got men pulling on ropes, you've got men running up there and lifting and moving things. You've got men having to haul the anchor out of the ground. So it's an enormously physical, strenuous kind of life.
Was it dangerous?
Very dangerous. No ship got through a cruise without somebody falling out of the rigging and landing on the deck or hitting the sea. If you fell from the main yard, the first one, you might survive. If you fell from the higher yards and hit the deck, you were dead. High risk, dangerous.
In fact, life at sea was so dangerous that grave digging at Haslar must have been a full-time job.
We've actually got tool marks on the top of the grave, so you can see the original spade marks. It's lovely.
I mean, they really are very, very clear, and literally, they do go all the way along.
That's right.
Great.
It really is nice to see somebody else's work, and knowing that, you know, it's nearly 200 years old is quite astonishing.
Most of the bodies here appear to be buried respectfully in neatly aligned single graves, but previous digs have revealed evidence that that wasn't always the case.
Oh, yeah, I mean, that's clearly a multiple burial. I mean, you've got one, two, three skulls in there.
That's right.
This practice of burying several bodies in one grave is surprisingly confirmed by a complaint about a local curate suspected of conducting job lot funerals here.
Curate College of Alverstoke. Where's that?
Is
that
Alverstoke is the next little town that's just a little bit over the wall, about a mile away.
Okay, so Curate College counters the query by pointing out that the convenient practice of burying four or even six or eight coffins in one grave has been superseded.
That's right.
Now, he writes, in the burying ground at Haslar, the order is to dig a single grave for every seaman that dies in the hospital. And the minister is expected to go that mile. Too right, he's got to go that mile, winter as well as summer, through a dirty road. into a bleak field, and with the pleasing reflection of him having earned 1 shilling. It says, I would hope that the commissioner will endeavour to procure such an augmentation of allowance, presumably a bit more.
He's saying, yes, a journey for 1 shilling, his time through the bleak midwinter, is not quite what he wants. And yes, he'd like an augmentation of allowance. That's right.
The bleak midwinter and frozen ground would have made it difficult to dig the number of graves needed, particularly if Haslar was dealing with casualties from a major battle.
What was 18th century warfare like?
This is close quarters naval battle, line of battleships firing broadsides at each other. You don't win these battles by skill, you don't win by single knockout blows. You basically have to kill and wound so many people on the opposing ship, they can't carry on.
So what would it have been like here on deck in the heat of battle?
These guns would have been going off probably twice a minute, so an enormous amount of noise, thick, acrid, choking smoke. And the enemy projectiles will be coming in, round shot, punching through the side of the ship, and then huge oak splinters being knocked off razor sharp. They'll take limbs off, they'll disembowel you. So the injuries that are suffered on this gun deck are absolutely appalling. And in many cases, the only treatment is to pick the remains up and throw them overboard.
So many of the worst injured wouldn't have even made it to Haslar. Those that didn't die immediately from their wounds were taken below and confronted with these and the ship's surgeon.
Most 19th century butchers would have recognised these instruments. They used them every day to saw up carcasses.
This looks a bit brutal.
That's a bone saw, and that's a critical part of the surgeon's kit. The biggest operation that the surgeon will perform on a regular basis is a major limb amputation. So if you're Nelson, for example, here's the tourniquet clamp. It goes right up high on your right arm, which is shattered at the elbow. Scalpel, strip away the flesh and the muscle from the bone, and then you get the bone saw at work. 30 seconds and you should be through. There's no anesthetic. It's got to be quick. Survival rates for major arm and leg amputations, 50-50.
So here, we have a very early example of surgery.
Yes, it's a fantastic example of a below-the-knee amputation. We have very clear marks made by the surgeon's saw.
I mean, the pain that this person must have gone through, not only when they had the injury, presumably to the foot or something like that, but presumably the only way to actually chop this off was literally to strap them down on the operating table and literally saw it off.
Yes, and in fact, we think that this individual actually died on the operating table because there's no evidence of any new bone formation. When we excavated this skeleton, we didn't find any evidence of his lower limb, but we did find another limb. An arm was found in the burial with him, and it clearly isn't his arm, as he has both of his.
So is this an amputation again?
Yes, it is. It's an amputated limb.
And in this case, the individual probably survived?
Very possibly, yeah.
Amputation was so common at Haslar that this is just one of several amputated limbs that doesn't belong to the occupant of the grave.
I'm concerned he might have a hand.
What?
What?
I'm concerned he's got a hand down here.
Do you reckon that's the sort of amputated end of...
That's of the humerus.
Yeah. Amputations were performed to save life, but the operation itself was risky. You could die from blood loss, and if you survived that, secondary infection loomed. But many deaths continued to puzzle doctors at Haslar.
What on earth has happened to the skull?
He has had an autopsy to determine the cause of death, and the top of his skull has been removed as part of the post-mortem examination.
They've literally sawn through. The cut goes from there...
All the way around.
Right the way around to there. So they've gone that way, and then they've gone that way.
Yes, we think they either used sharp knives or a wire to cut through his skull. And if we take the cranium off, we can see the surgeon's tool marks here.
Oh, good Lord, yeah. I mean, it's a sort of very, very brutal piece of carpentry, but absolutely amazing.
Postmortems like this one were performed regularly by doctors at Haslar, either in response to outbreaks of disease or to investigate illnesses that sailors contracted overseas.
They're able to see a wide range of diseases, including many exotic diseases. And so the physicians who were working there had the opportunity to dissect people who died from diseases, not only like typhus and consumption, which were common in Britain, but also diseases such as malaria and yellow fever. And these were opportunities that many physicians working in Britain just simply did not have.
Haslar was in the vanguard of medicine in other ways too. It had one of the lowest mortality rates of any hospital in Europe, thanks largely to this man. If anyone embodied the pioneering spirit of Haslar, it was its chief physician, James Lind. Lind was a surgeon's apprentice before joining the Navy and worked his way up to ship's surgeon. During his time at sea, he saw for himself what killed most sailors in the 18th century.
Oh, it's a bit of a tight squeeze between the bunks.
Yeah, you've got to get nearly 300 men on board on this deck, and that's all the space you've got. That's your hammock stretcher, about 14 inches. Everybody's cheek by jowl, jammed together, head to toe, all the way along the deck here.
There must have been quite a risk of infection.
Once you get an infectious disease on board, something like typhus, which is spread by lice on dirty bodies, unwashed clothes, it's going to spread through the whole ship. It's almost impossible to stop it. And some ships were in such a bad state they could hardly navigate, let alone fight a battle. So disease is the biggest single problem in the 18th century Navy.
Lind recommended a series of reforms which turned cleanliness into a Royal Naval mania. He proposed slop ships to de-louse new recruits, better ventilation and fumigation, and the quarantine of contagious ships. And in 1758, when Lind arrived at Haslar, he introduced a radical system of infection control.
Lind insisted that all newly admitted patients should be given a bath in hot soapy water and provided with clean clothing for the duration of their stay. He separated patients with different infectious diseases, and he separated the surgical wards from the fever wards. This was a remarkable advance for its time, an enlightened attempt to prevent cross-infection and the spread of diseases.
Lind's reforms dramatically reduced the mortality rate at Haslar and kept infectious diseases under control. But there was still something deadly stalking the decks, an illness even Lind couldn't fathom.
There was one disease that killed more sailors than war, shipwreck, and all the other illnesses combined. It was the scourge of the Royal Navy and the great medical mystery of the age of sail. It had baffled doctors since the days of the ancient Greeks. That killer was scurvy.
Scurvy is caused by a deficiency of vitamin C, preventing the body producing connective tissue. Its symptoms range from spots on the skin, bleeding gums and tooth loss, to the reopening of old wounds and severe blood loss. If untreated, it's fatal.
There were officers in Nelson's day who were covered in bayonet and cutlass wounds, and if they got the scurvy, the wounds just opened up, even a decade after the event. So it gradually turns you into a complete invalid, and then you die.
Haslar's chief physician, James Lind, treated thousands of patients with scurvy, and the dig has found potential evidence of the disease on many of its skeletons.
We can't tell conclusively how he died, but we can tell that he has some evidence of vitamin deficiency. We can see unusual porosity in his orbits. These little dots in here.
Oh, what you mean is like honeycombing pattern in the roof of the eye socket?
Yes, he could either have been suffering from iron deficiency anemia or from scurvy.
Which, of course, was the scourge of the British Navy, wasn't it?
Yeah. Especially because this one is so young.
How can you tell that?
We can tell by looking at the formation of his bones. These blobs on the ends of the bones, they gradually fuse onto the rest of the bone as a person grows up. And because these are not fused, we can tell that he's about 14 to 16.
14 to 16? Well, that's virtually no more than a boy, really.
Indeed.
The risk of scurvy increased the longer a ship stayed at sea. And in the 18th century, that could be for months or even years. 6 weeks into a voyage, all fresh food ran out, leaving only the ship's stores of preserved food.
Was this standard fare for an 18th century English sailor?
Yep, this is about it. You've got some salt meat and you've got some split peas.
Well, peas are all right, but they're a bit salty.
Well, salt is the standard preservative. This has got to stay on the ship for months and even years on end.
Biscuit's a bit hard.
Just baked flour and water. That's all it is. It'll last forever.
I'm going to break my teeth trying to eat this.
Yeah.
Was it good for you, a diet like this, though?
This is a really good diet so far as it goes, but it's missing critical vitamins. There are no fresh vegetables. You're going to be short of things that we now know are vital to sustained long-term health.
Scurvy caused one of the worst disasters in naval history. 1,400 men died as Commodore George Anson sailed a squadron of six warships round the world in 1740. Lind had recently joined the Navy, and it was the shadow of this disaster that drove him to find a cure.
The defeat of scurvy would transform the capabilities of the Navy and rank as one of the great medical advances of the time. Lind put some so-called scurvy cures to the test by conducting the first known medical trial and found that the answer lay in this, the humble lemon.
Lind conducted his trial while serving as a ship's surgeon in 1747. He took six pairs of sailors with scurvy and gave each pair a different scurvy remedy. A sulfuric acid mixture, vinegar, seawater, a laxative, cider, and oranges and lemons. Only the pair given fruit recovered. But in an age before people understood what vitamins were, even Lind failed to grasp the significance of his own results. And when he published his findings, they were virtually ignored.
Lind's own recommendations were very mixed. He didn't pick out any single cure. He didn't say it was just simply the lack of citrus fruits or the lack of fresh vegetables. He thought there were other factors involved, like the lack of pure air, poor sanitation and hygiene and laziness, because a lack of physical discipline would actually predispose the body to rotting, which he thought was one of the things that actually gave rise to scurvy.
Lind retired from Haslar, believing he still hadn't found a cure. But his research survived and was rediscovered by other naval physicians who realised that Lind had found the answer. The Admiralty was finally persuaded to issue daily rations of lemon juice in 1795, 48 years after Lind's experiment and, tragically, a year after his death.
Is that pretty consistent, Bev, the way the hands are kind of just draped down to the side, or are they brought across the pelvis?
Quite often in the pelvis.
In the pelvis?
Yeah. So do you think that they've been tied?
Either that or the coffins have been made very, very narrow.
The reforms to diet and hygiene led to naval health improving dramatically in the late 18th century. Sickness rates fell by three quarters and the death rate by two thirds. By the time it came to the Battle of Trafalgar in 1805, the men in Nelson's fleet were significantly healthier and so more effective than their French and Spanish opponents.
Come and have a look at this one. It's an absolute cracker. Just eat. Look at that.
Wow.
Look at that. Look at that.
That's
isn't that amazing?
Really very different.
Isn't that amazing?
This piece here might actually well be the corner of the coffin when it's collapsed.
A kind of joint.
That may well be the joint at the corner.
I mean, that's what you're looking at there, what, 200-year-old wood?
Yeah.
I still find slightly frustrating as you never get a coffin plate or something like that. It said, here lies so-and-so, and you could, you know, it would be lovely. The rest of it,
it's not like... Identifying individual skeletons here looks like a lost cause, because there appear to be no coffin plates or fragments of uniform. But the dig has now exhumed 30 skeletons, And surprisingly, it's the bones themselves that may identify which men are likely to be officers or ratings. It's an opportunity for some detective work by Cranfield University's anthropologist, Dr. Anna Williams, and Time Team's osteoarchaeologist, Jackie McKinley.
Can we get any impression of the jobs that people were doing from looking at their skeletons generally? Can you see if some people were engaged in things that might use their upper bodies more and say, as opposed to, I don't know, the officers who might be just wandering around?
Well, we have noticed the robust muscle attachments in the upper arms in particular. This is one of the taller ones in our sample.
Right, look at that. That's one of the forearm bones. And you can see this big crest sticking up here. That's called the supinator crest, and that enables you to turn those muscles. He's been turning those arm muscles quite strongly. His legs are strong as well. So he's been doing sort of maybe a multiplicity of tasks that have made all parts of his body strong.
While Phil and Jackie continue to look for evidence on the bones, Helen's off to the National Archives to meet naval historian Professor Eric Grove. Haslar treated many casualties from the Battle of Trafalgar when the fleet returned from southern Spain, and they're keen to find out if any ended up in the cemetery. Their starting point is Haslar's muster book, which lists the name and the ship of every man admitted to the hospital.
There's hundreds and hundreds. I mean, how can we find the people who came from Trafalgar?
Well, we know that the ships which had fought at Trafalgar began to arrive at Portsmouth from the beginning of December 1805. Here we are. Those are the names of the ships,
Illustrious,
yes.
Colossus. Amazon. Oh, that's Assault. Do we have any from Victory?
Oh, there, I think.
Oh, yes.
Victory.
There's just one.
Just one,
Golly.
Yes.
Richard Colliver. Oh, and look, Consumption. DD, what's that?
Discharged dead.
Oh, I suppose you would have to be discharged.
The last thing on your report, yes.
Yes.
The wounded at Trafalgar, including many from HMS Victory, were taken initially to the Naval Hospital in Gibraltar. 22-year-old Richard Colliver survived the battle and the six-week journey home, only to die of tuberculosis the day after he reached Haslar. Death from disease was always a far greater threat to sailors than war.
What can you tell us about things like that would have happened to them while they were in service? Maybe infections and things like that.
Here we've got a nice example of periostitis, which is an inflammation of the periosteum, which is the outer sheath of the bone. See these striations here? This is new bone formation that's being laid down as a result of inflammation.
Is this therefore a wound that this person has had on the leg that's got infected?
Being on the shin bone, it could be related to some kind of ulceration, some long-running sore in the soft tissue overlying the bone directly, or it could have travelled on some focus of infection elsewhere in the body, because the tibia, the lower leg particularly, is prone to getting infections like that. And if you look at this, you can see it's a woven appearance to the bone. Now, that tells us that this was actually active at the time of death.
How many other examples among the collection have you got of infection?
About 40% of our collection has this non-specific infection of the periosteum.
At the archives, Helen and Eric have now found 129 men from the Trafalgar ships who were admitted to Haslar. 52 of them came from one ship, HMS Temeraire, and half of them were treated for the sort of infection Phil and Jackie have seen on the bones from the cemetery.
What does that say?
Ulcer.
Ulcer?
Ulcer, yeah. A very common complaint among sailors at that time. These are infected sores on the skin, some of them quite big.
Oh, my goodness, how horrible.
Now, it could have been caused by a wound, right, getting infected, and not healing. So hence it became an ulcer.
The Temeraire does seem to be the ship. Yes, look, there's pages and pages of Temeraire people.
She suffered quite serious casualties, not the worst, but she was very heavily engaged in the battle. And you can see all these wounded people here. Wounded,
yes.
Ditto, yes.
Is there any way of finding out what kinds of wounds they might have had?
We have amputation thigh, fractured arm, amputated arm, fractured arm, amputation, another amputation.
Wow.
Wound on left leg, yes.
Gosh, they're horrific, aren't
they? Yes, they are, that's right. Lacerated wound on thigh, and so on.
So what was the Temeraire's role in the Battle of Trafalgar?
She saved HMS Victory.
In the Trafalgar battle plan, the Temeraire was to play a critical role. Nelson's now famous tactic was to attack in two columns to break up the enemy line and force a close quarters contest. He weighted his column for maximum impact, placing HMS Victory at the head and the Temeraire directly behind in support.
How did the crew of the Temeraire behave? Why do you think they fought so bravely?
The astonishing thing about life in the Navy in Nelson's day is after a few weeks, a few months, the whole world is the ship. And within the ship, it's your mess, your mates, your watch, your little unit. They're fighting for each other. So beyond the whole business of small unit camaraderie, there's something else. There's Nelson. He really is unique. Nelson is the first admiral in the history of war at sea to send a signal to every man in his fleet. He says England expects that every man will do his duty. And of course, that's exactly what he does during the battle. Where is he? He's right in the most dangerous part of the most exposed ship in the whole battle.
Nelson was shot right there on the quarterdeck of HMS Victory by a sharpshooter from the French ship Redoubtable. The French then attempted to board the Victory, but were thwarted by the arrival of HMS Temeraire, which fired a devastating broadside at the French. After raking the Redoubtable with fire, the Temeraire then came under attack from the French ship, the Fougueux. Sandwiched between these two enemy ships, the Temeraire fought both to a standstill. A lot of the men from the Temeraire were badly injured, and when the fleet arrived back in port, those men went to Haslar.
Temeraire, as the ship that came through the smoke of battle and rescued the Victory and played this decisive, heroic part in the melee around Nelson's flagship, was right up there, after Victory, the most famous ship in the country. And that was a reputation that would endure until it became something absolutely iconic.
The Temeraire, immortalised by Turner, was right at the heart of the fighting and played a critical part in Nelson's Victory. But did any of those wounded sailors who made it to Haslar get out of the hospital alive, or did they all end up here, among the 8,000 buried in the cemetery?
Okay, so we're going to lift the right humerus.
An estimated 8,000 men are buried at Haslar Naval Hospital, some having served under Nelson at the Battle of Trafalgar.
Oh, it's too low! Spread a diagonal. Yeah. Cool.
We're keen to uncover any clues as to what rank these men were, either from the excavated bones or through naval records. At the National Archives, Helen and Eric are searching HMS Temeraire's muster book. 52 wounded members of her crew were treated at Haslar after saving Nelson's flagship.
Landsmen? I mean, this turns up a lot in this column. What was a landsman?
A large proportion of landsmen there. They're the unskilled labourers of the ship.
The Temeraire's records show that a quarter of her crew were landsmen, logged here as LM, all with less than a year's experience at sea.
The ages here are quite interesting. I mean, they're mainly young men, about 20 or 21, yes, but there were people much younger in the ship, boys of the third class, and modern people find it, I think, very surprising, the ages of the people here who were serving in a combat zone.
My goodness.
12 when he joined the ship, 10 when he joined the ship. That's pretty young, even by the standards of the day. One thing that was done was seen as a way of getting poor boys without much of a future a life. Better to go to sea than live in the gutters of a British city.
Do we know of anybody who's sent to Haslar?
Well, let's have a look down the column. Yes, this Irishman.
John McManigal.
McManigal, yes. And he ends up in Haslar Hospital.
Yes. Gosh, and how old is he? He's 12, yes. Wow.
We've discovered that the Temeraire wounded who fought so bravely and ended up here at Haslar were all ratings, men and boys from the lower deck of Nelson's Navy. And the bones recovered from the cemetery are beginning to paint a picture of the background of those sailors. A quarter of these men suffered from a deficiency of iron in their diet as children, and a fifth show another condition caused by childhood deprivation.
There is some evidence of childhood rickets that has now healed. Mm. And you can see that this shin bone is really quite bowed along this area.
So how old was he when he died?
Between 17 and 25.
So when he's a child, he's had a deficiency of vitamin D, which is contained in what sort of...
Things like milk and dairy products.
Is it curable?
We get a lot of vitamin D from sunlight. If this chap's then become a sailor as a young man, he will have got all the sunlight he required in order to be able to mend those bones. By the time he was in the Navy, his diet was probably better than he'd had as he was growing up. But obviously, he died as quite a young man. One of the other things that struck me looking around, actually, it's so little dental tooth decay. And that is one of the things that also suggests that they're not coming from a very wealthy background. Because at that time, you had to be middle class or better off to be able to afford sugar. But if you could afford sugar, you had rotten teeth, absolutely rotten. So these guys are actually far better off than a lot of the people who were better off than they were.
The high proportion of skeletons showing signs of childhood deprivation makes it likely that these men are Navy rank and file, drawn from the working classes. For many, the Navy presented an escape from the widespread poverty of Georgian Britain. But they almost certainly died younger than their civilian counterparts. More than a third died as teenagers, most were under 35, and no one here lived beyond the age of 45. Our research into those who were wounded on the Temeraire and were treated here at Haslar has revealed that more than a third of them were so badly injured they had to be discharged from the Navy. But nearly half recovered and were sent back to active service. Clearly, the hospital was doing what the Navy wanted it to do, curing the sick and wounded and sending them back to work at sea. And at least two were among many Trafalgar veterans who ended up here, Greenwich Hospital. Now the old Royal Naval College, the hospital was originally built in 1696 as a retirement home for old and injured sailors.
It just seems absolutely incredible that somebody who comes from, you know, was quite low-born in a sense, from the working classes, could go into the Navy and yet end their days in a place like this.
It's a sign, I think, of how important the Navy was. Of course, it's a great statement as well. This is British sea power in stone. Look what we do for our sailors. Welcome to one of the greatest rooms in the world.
My goodness.
It's amazing, isn't it?
Pretty overwhelming.
And of course, one of the greatest protagonists of Britain's naval power, Nelson, lay in state here.
Oh my goodness.
We've pieced together a picture of what happened to the Temeraire men after they left Haslar. There were always many more applicants than spaces at Greenwich, but landsman Archibald Anderson was one of the lucky few who secured a place.
Archibald Anderson, a Scotsman, he'd been wounded at Trafalgar.
Blown up at Trafalgar.
Yes. Some kind of concussion, yes. Presumably. But he goes back to service, he's discharged.
Yeah, and he comes here when he's 57.
When he's 57 years.
And then he dies here.
In 1855.
20 years later.
Yeah, so he dies at 77, that's pretty good going.
Exactly, he was here for 20 years.
Yes.
Surprisingly, Archibald Anderson's longevity was typical for Greenwich pensioners. Like a third of the Temeraire wounded, many of these hardened survivors would have been discharged from the Navy because of the severity of their injuries, but lived well into old age nonetheless.
So what do we know in general about our Temeraire wounded who made it back to Haslar?
I mean, 21 of them, of the 52, they recover and they go back to service. And one of the ones which I think pleases one most is one of the youngest, a young Irishman who we found in the muster book. John
McManagall.
McManagall, yes. Boy third class, age 12. He was discharged to another ship in 1806 and then went on and rejoined the fleet.
So those would be the success stories. What about those who didn't make it out of the hospital?
Four of them, in fact. And interestingly, they all died of infection. They all died of ulcers.
So those would have been the people who'd be buried in our cemetery at the hospital?
Those are the people buried in the cemetery, yes. And one of the most touching stories here, Landsman Willis, 21, from Carmarthen. And because he's nobody else, he isn't married or anything, he leaves his prize money and his parliamentary award to his mother.
Poor chap.
A story, sadly, without a happy ending.
Mm.
So William Willis is somewhere amongst the 8,000 buried here.
What's that?
A pin!
A pin!
We found a pin.
It's broken as it is. It seems to have come from, well, from the radius, perhaps. There's a bandage around his arm. That's very exciting.
We can't find his grave, as any burial markers above ground were removed long ago. But as the dig draws to a close, the finds below ground continue to shed light on the burials afforded to men like Willis.
That's very cool.
All the individuals that we've excavated have been buried in wooden coffins. They have been test done and all of the coffins have come up as being pine.
Right. And pine's quite a cheap wood, isn't it?
Yes, it would have been.
So they had really bargain basement coffins. What about inside the coffins? Were they buried in their clothes?
Well, there's no evidence at all that we found that they actually wore their own clothes. We believe that the individuals would have been buried in shrouds.
What happened to all their personal effects and clothing and so on?
Well, the clothing and personal effects would have either been given to the family, if the family was known, or it was given to the messmates, who then auctioned off the clothes or the personal effects to pay for the burial.
I suppose it just emphasises how poor the people were who were
buried. Absolutely, yes, it would have done.
8,000 men who died while fighting for their country are buried underneath the ground I'm now walking on. We now know that most of them were naval rank and file rather than officers, who were perhaps more likely to have been buried in some family churchyard somewhere. What really strikes me is how much we know about their lives from the naval records, whereas in death, they're completely anonymous. In life, sailors were a valuable commodity, but their deaths reflect how poor they really were. If there were ever any grave markers here, it's likely they weren't grand tombstones, but simple wooden ones. This old burial ground will continue to remind us of the cost of Britain's hard-won naval supremacy. And Haslar itself stands as a very visible monument to the importance of the Navy to Britain. Its sheer scale, a reflection of the need for a steady supply of battle-ready sailors. All the bodies that have been exhumed from the cemetery by the archaeologists are to be given a military reburial with due honours. It's a sobering thought that that's probably far more than they had first time round.